If we'll go ahead and turn to Matthew 5. I'm going to primarily look at four verses today, but in doing so, you know I always use a lot more verses than that. If you've not been here before, through the door on the right-hand side, you will find outlines, and they will list the majority of verses that I will use. I say the majority because I will throw some in on occasion, so you might be prepared to write those down if you follow along in the outline. We're going to look at Matthew 5, 17 through 20 this morning. This is a passage of Scripture that many out in the religious world do not understand, and so it's good for us to go back and review some of these basics. You know, there are many today in the church who believe that sermons really ought to only be preached with positive presentation and very little negative correction. And sometimes that is appropriate and beneficial. Let me just tell you, I'd much rather preach those types of sermons all the time, right? And yet, we understand that's not what we can do. But again, this isn't going to be one of those so much, but we're going to look at the example here with Jesus, because in his own sermons, he demonstrates that oftentimes negative correction is needed. And we see here in Matthew 5:17 that he's beginning this lengthy discourse against the religious leaders of the day who were guilty of going out and they were perverting the old law. And they even went so far as to claim that Jesus was one who spoke evil of the law, and then he even came so that he could destroy the law. They made some pretty wild accusations against our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Jesus, he didn't come to minimize. He didn't come to ridicule the Old Testament. You think about Jesus, he was a Jew living under the law, right? So why would they make such claims? There's quite a few different reasons why the Pharisees and the scribes at the time would accuse Jesus of this. We won't go into all of those today. But Jesus knew from the very beginning that the law was holy, that it was just, and that it was good. Many people have this idea that there was always something lacking in the old law and that it was inferior. There was some things lacking in the law that we do find now in the New Testament under the covenant in which we live today, but we need to understand as we go back and we look at the Old Testament, it was just, it was holy, it was good. And if you go back and you look at David, listen to what he writes, because he understood this. Psalms 19, 7 through 11, he writes, "The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. The statutes of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. More to be desired are they than gold, yea, than much fine gold, sweeter also than honey and the honeycomb. And moreover, by them is thy servant warned, and in keeping of them there is great reward." I find it very interesting that David so well understood the importance of the law. He goes on in Psalms 119, 105, and he says, "Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path." He very well understood that which was guiding him, that which was directing his steps, had to be the Word of God. So what was the problem with the old law? The problem was never with the law in and of itself. The problem was that you had an imperfect man trying to keep a perfect law, and because he couldn't keep the perfect law, he was guilty of sin, right? And he didn't have a way to deal with that problem. And so there had to be a way for those who were in this situation to be able to resolve this situation. Many of the Jews, they had this misconception concerning the law. And so this led to this false accusation against our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, in Matthew 5, 17 through 20. Jesus gives us a much deeper insight into his mission and the purpose of the Old Testament. I'm going to read it here in just a second, Matthew 5, 17 through 20. And I want to remind you that you're going to come into contact with a lot of people who still think that there are portions of the old law that are in effect today. How many of you have talked with somebody who talked about worshiping on the Sabbath? Or has tried to bring back some of those things we find under the old law? Well, many people don't have an understanding about the law, the purpose of the law, but Jesus is going to make it very clear here in Matthew 5, 17 through 20, what the purpose of the old law was. Listen to Matthew 5, 17 through 20. Think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets. I'm not come to destroy, but to fulfill. For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall no wise pass from the law till all be fulfilled. Whosoever therefore shall break one of these least commandments and shall teach men so, he shall be called the least in the kingdom of heaven. But whosoever shall do and teach them, the same shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I say unto you that except your righteousness shall exceed the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, ye shall in no case enter into the kingdom of heaven. Well, this passage that I just read, Matthew 5, 17 through 20, really serves as the introduction into what's going to follow in Matthew 5, 21 through 48. And I'd encourage you to go back and read that today if you get a chance. You'll have a greater understanding. Well, I want to focus on Matthew 5, 20 here for just a second. Notice he says, "For I say unto you that except your righteousness shall exceed the righteousness of the scribes and the Pharisees, ye shall in no case enter into the kingdom of heaven." This really sets the stage for Jesus' main point throughout this speech right here. His point was that the righteousness of the scribes and the Pharisees, now he's talking about their doctrine and about their practice, it wasn't synonymous with a true righteousness that pleases God. How many of you would say you know a Christian or someone who claims to be a Christian who doesn't act like a Christian? Most of us hate to admit it, but we know people like that. And that's what Jesus is pointing out here regarding these scribes and the Pharisees. Now, these Jewish scribes and the Pharisees at the time, let's just understand, they had a lot of religious enthusiasm. If you go back, you'll find that many of them were very active. They're a lot like people today who are caught up in the idea of being religious. I come into contact with people quite often who will describe that, oftentimes they describe themselves as religious or spiritual. And we find that going on here with these scribes and the Pharisees. The problem was their actual practice of religion was filled with ignorance. Okay, does that sound familiar? That's the type of environment we're in today. And I want you to listen to how Paul describes these Jews. Romans 10, 1 through 3. He says, "Brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they might be saved. For I bear them record that they have a zeal of God, but not according to knowledge. For they, being ignorant of God's righteousness and going about to establish their own righteousness, have not submitted themselves unto the righteousness of God." It makes it very clear that the Jews at that time who had this zeal, who were trying to be righteous in God's sight, but were enacting their own ways to achieve this righteousness, were in fact not righteous at all because they wouldn't submit themselves to God's will. We have that going on today, don't we? I don't say that with excitement and feeling good about that. I don't feel good that there are people out there who've not yet been taught the gospel. As a matter of fact, I hope that those people are brought into contact with us so we can teach them the truth. Jesus very clearly is making a point about these scribes and these Pharisees. They're not acting in a way that's righteous. Jesus, again, when he came to teach, and many, I think, don't understand his true purpose, Jesus didn't come to contradict the teachings of the law of Moses. When you begin to look at what Jesus taught, and we just have to admit, if you were a Jew at the time and you heard Jesus teach you, you'd say, now wait a minute, what he's teaching is different than the religious law that I'm living under. And it was. It contradicted what they were living under, but it didn't contradict the law of Moses. Does that make sense? They were living under religious laws as Jews, and Jesus taught certain things, and they would say, no, wait a minute, that contradicts what I've been taught. But the problem was they weren't living under just the law of Moses. They were living under the law of Moses plus whatever else they added. And you begin to think about people today who are many of them striving to be Christians, and yet they add to the law of Christ those things that they think need to be done. Many of them sincere, many of them trying to do right, and yet they simply don't understand that by adding and taking away, they're not righteous in his sight. Jesus didn't come to contradict the law of Moses, but it did. The Lord's work in teaching was a very logical sequence in following up the Old Testament writings. Okay? It only made sense. When Jesus came, he didn't come to contradict. He came to build upon. And you're going to understand why to clarify this misconception about what the Jews were saying about him, that he came to destroy the law, that he came to contradict it. In one dramatic, sweeping declaration, Jesus affirms that he is actually the fulfillment of the law. Now, for those who would have been in the audience who would have understood that, that might have angered some people right off the bat. And for those who didn't, who maybe came to that understanding, it probably would have been extremely well received. Jesus' relationship to the old law was one of fulfillment. Listen to what he says in Matthew 5:17. He says, "Think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets. I'm not come to destroy, but to fulfill." Right? What he is saying is simply this, if I can paraphrase. For all you Jews who've been reading your Old Testament about this coming Messiah, guess what? I'm him. And you would know that I'm him if you would go back and you would look at the Old Testament law, because I fulfill that Old Testament law that you're reading about. This is something that we as believers and those who want to become believers need to logically think about for a second. Jesus just told these people that he was the Messiah. Here's what they need to ask. Is this man actually the Messiah? Is he telling me the truth? Is he a liar? Or is he crazy? I can't think of another category that he would fall into. The Jews of the time should have been asking that. And anybody today who wants to become a Christian ought to be asking the same thing. This man claims to be the Son of God living in the flesh. So is he telling me the truth? Is he a liar? Or is he crazy? I know for a fact he's not crazy. Crazy goes against everything that our Lord and Savior taught. The gospel, the New Testament, his teachings only made sense. Nothing in there would lead me to believe that our Lord and Savior was crazy. Now I have to ask the next two questions. Was he telling me the truth or was he lying? For Jesus to lie would again contradict everything that he taught. It wouldn't be synonymous with the way that he lived his life or the things that he taught. So I know he wasn't lying to me. So the next question then is this. Is he telling me the truth when he says he's my Lord and Savior? Because he made it very clear here that he came to fulfill the law. Not only does he say, I am the Lord and Savior, by saying he came to fulfill the law, he's letting them know that if you would go back and check your Old Testament prophecies, you would see that I'm the fulfillment of every one of those. Therefore, you understand that I am the Lord and Savior that you've been waiting for. I think when people look at who is Jesus today in this type of a study, you're going to find that he indeed was Jesus Christ, the Messiah. He wasn't just some good man. I've heard people say that Jesus, he wasn't the Messiah, but he was a good man. Good men don't lie to you and tell you that they're something that they're not. He was the Messiah. And he says, I came to fulfill this law. Listen to what Paul writes in Romans 10:4. This is what we started off with. For Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone that believeth. When you go back and you look in the Greek, what you're going to find is that word in there is actually could be translated as aim, or he was the goal. For he is the aim of the law. He was the goal of the law. The entire intent for the Old Testament was pointing to the fact that there was a Messiah who was coming, and Christ says, guess what? I'm him that came to fulfill that. Now this confuses some, but Paul was trying to make it very clear here in Romans 10:4 that Jesus brought the old law to completion. Okay? You know, I mentioned quite often the most important page for us as Christians is that blank page right between the Old Testament and the New Testament. People say, what do I need to do to be righteous in God's sight? Open up to that blank page. Let me face the way you're facing. Open up to the blank page and everything to that side. That's what you need to be doing. That is the faith. That's the law of Christ. That's how we're righteous in God's sight. And Christ came to bring that old law to completion, and we have the New Testament that talks about it. Listen to Hebrews 8:13. In that he saith a new covenant. He's talking about the New Testament. He hath made the first old. He's talking about the Old Testament. Now that which decayeth and waxeth old is ready to vanish away. Our Lord and Savior came to institute a brand new law, right? We weren't going to continue to live under this Old Testament law. Many people, again, they don't understand, why do we have the Old Testament? Why do we have the New Testament? They seem to be different. They don't go together. And the whole intent was for the old law to eventually stop. You know, we've been studying the book of Romans. And what we learned very quick, we outline chapters 1, 2, 3, and 4. He starts off, I'll paraphrase, guess what? For the most part, the Gentiles were lost. Chapter 1, guess what? Chapter 2, Jew, you're no better. But guess what? Chapter 3, there's a place where we can all be saved. That's in the church. Chapter 4, how? by faith. What kind of faith? A living, obedient faith, not by faith only. Romans chapter 4 is so mistaught. And that's what he's trying to get us to understand here. I came to fulfill that old law so that the new law could come into effect. Hebrews 10:9. Then said he, lo, I come to do thy will, O God. He taketh away the first, that he may establish the second. There's no two laws in effect at the same time, right? When we change the laws, I think I heard the other day that they're thinking about raising the speed limit on the highway out there. When the old laws changed, the new one goes into effect. How many of you would be confused if you drove down the highway and every other sign said 75, 70? Would that confuse you? When the new law comes into effect, it's in effect. The old law's gone. That's what he says here. He came to put away that old law so that the new law could come into effect. We as Christians live under this new law. Now that old law, it wasn't really inferior. It had a divine purpose. However, it was time for the new law. Jesus didn't come to destroy the law. I find it even amazing that they would accuse him of this. That word destroy comes from this Greek word, katalousai. It means to overthrow, to deprive of success, to bring to naught, to discard, to invalidate. Our Lord and Savior didn't come to do any of those things to the law of Moses. But his life and work wasn't designed to put down or compete with the Old Testament. His mission was to fulfill that Old Testament. The law nonstop in the Old Testament foretold of the fact that there was going to be a Messiah coming. I talked about how oftentimes at the Passover, it's not a trait that many do anymore. But during the Passover, the Jews would often leave an empty seat at the table. And that was because they were waiting on their Lord and Savior. They were waiting for Him to come. And Jesus now tells them, I am that one you're waiting for. I am the fulfillment of the law. We need to remember this very carefully, and I think this would help all of us as Christians. The Old Testament is the New Testament concealed. And what I mean by that is the Old Testament has all the prophecies. It's pointing towards the New Testament. So the Old Testament is the New Testament concealed. It's not been revealed yet, but it's pointing. It's saying, wait, look. You go to Joel chapter 2, Isaiah chapter 2, and all of them are pointing to this time, especially when the church is going to come in. But the New Testament is the Old Testament revealed. Because we read about things in the New Testament and we go, wow, wait a minute, that's a prophecy from the Old Testament. Now I understand it. And you wonder why we as Christians, we live according to the New Testament, but why do we need the Old Testament? Because it aids in our understanding. Because when I read the New Testament, I can say, wait a minute, that's a prophecy being fulfilled right there. Whether that prophecy is talking about our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, or whether that prophecy is talking about the establishment of the church, or whether that prophecy is talking about the end times when Jesus will return, I can look at that and I can say, I can have complete faith and understanding in my Bible, which was written by over 40 different men who had 40 different occupations from 40 different places, most of them who didn't know each other, and each of them wrote a book which didn't contradict any other book in the Bible and shows me that this word is completely 100% inspired and without error. And therefore, I can know that Jesus is my Lord and Savior who came to fulfill this law. There's over 300 different prophecies in the Old Testament specifically related to Christ or to the establishment of the church. Let me give you just a couple of examples real quick in the Old Testament, specifically pointing towards our Lord and Savior. I could give you a lot, but these two in particular. Deuteronomy 18:15. The Lord thy God will raise up unto thee a prophet from the midst of thee, of thy brethren like unto me, unto him ye shall hearken. Moses makes it, we see very clearly here as we look at the scriptures that there was going to be a prophet who would come. And Moses makes it very clear that there's a prophet who's coming. It's funny, Islam teaches that this is Muhammad. It's not. It's not Muhammad. Very clearly, this is the Messiah. Let me pause for just a second. If any of you are confused by the idea that we as Christians worship the same God as Islam, many people think out in the world that Christians and those who are the Islamic faith worship the same God. I assure you that's not true. And so if that's not something you've ever studied or you're curious about it, ask me on the door. Me and another gentleman wrote probably a 130-page thing on that. I'll send it to you in the email or print it out for you and give it to you. Moses makes it very clear there's another prophet who's going to come. He's talking about the Messiah. We see in Deuteronomy 18, 18 through 19, he says, I will raise them up a prophet from among their brethren like unto thee, and I will put my words in his mouth, and he shall speak unto them all that I shall command him. And it shall come to pass that whosoever will not hearken unto my words, which he shall speak in my name, I will require it of him. How many times did Jesus go back and actually speak the words of Moses, the law of Moses? Time and time again, he did. These prophecies all foretold about the fact that there was a Messiah coming, but those prophecies also talked about the fact that there was going to be an establishment of the church. The church, singular. I'm not sure why many people get so offended when we talk about there's one church with one doctrine. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on it this morning, but here's what I understand. There were prophecies that from very old said, guess what? There's going to be this establishment of a place for God's people under this new law. And today people are willing to admit that half of that's true. They'll admit that there is a place for God's people, but then they seem to forget about the fact that God's law applies to those people. Listen to what we see recorded in Daniel 2:44. This is not a passage you're familiar with. I would encourage you to go back and spend a little time in Daniel. Daniel's can be a tough read, but he has a lot of prophecies. In verse 44, he says, and in the days of these kings shall the God of heaven set up a kingdom which shall never be destroyed, and the kingdom shall not be left to other people, but it shall break in pieces and consume all these kingdoms, and it shall stand forever. Daniel says there in chapter 2, verse 44, that during this period of the Roman Empire, there's going to be an establishment that's going to last forever. This kingdom I'm talking about. And the kingdom he's talking about was the church. This kingdom came into effect on the day of Pentecost. We see the church was established. Jesus, throughout his ministry, even said that the fulfillment of Daniel's prophecy was now at hand. Listen to Mark 1, 14 through 15. Now after that, John was put in prison. Jesus came into Galilee, preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God and saying, the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent ye and believe the gospel. He could say that because guess what? The kingdom was about to come into effect there on the day of Pentecost. There was going to be the establishment of this church. And we understand that the church lived according to the teachings of Jesus and the apostles. We know that the scriptures were given. The scriptures were then fulfilled. And they lived according to those. That's what the church was. I mentioned this last week. If you'd have run into a first century Christian and said, oh, hey, it's nice to meet you. I've not been to this city. Which Christian denomination are you part of? He'd have looked at you like you were crazy, right? There was no such thing. There was no division amongst Christians. There was one faith, and there was one body. Now, there may have been multiple groups meeting, but they all had unity in the faith. They believed the same thing, and they were just Christians. Nothing more, nothing less. That's what we need to get back to today, right? We've got so much religious division in this world, people teaching things they ought not to teach. We need to get back. We need to get back to what the purpose of Jesus came. He was the fulfillment of this law so that he could institute the new law. The old law had done its job. It was pointing, saying, there's a Christ coming. The Messiah is coming. He's going to institute this new law. Listen to Galatians 3, 19 through 25. Wherefore then serveth the law? What was its purpose, he says? It was added because of transgressions. Oh, it was added because people kept sinning. Till the seed should come to whom the promise was made. And it was ordained by angels in the hand of a mediator. Now, a mediator is not a mediator of one, but God is one. Is the law then against the promise of God? He says, God forbid. For if there had been a law given which could have given life, verily righteousness should have been by the law. But the Scripture hath concluded all under sin, that the promise by faith of Jesus Christ might be given to them that believe. But before faith came, we were kept under the law, shut up under the faith which should afterwards be revealed. Wherefore, the law was our schoolmaster to bring us unto Christ, that we might be justified by faith. But after that faith has come, we're no longer under a schoolmaster. He makes it very clear. The purpose of the old law was to bring us to Christ. It was our schoolmaster. It was to bring us, as he says here in verse 24, so that we could be justified by faith. Not faith only, James 2:24, by the faith, Ephesians 2:8 and 9, through the system of faith, through the law of Christ. Many today struggle with this idea of the old law and what its purpose was. And Christ makes it very clear. I am the fulfillment of the old law to bring you the new law. And the new law is what you're going to live under. Jesus said in Matthew 5:18, "For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law till all be fulfilled." He says, guess what? This old law, the Old Testament that I'm talking about, and remember, Jesus Christ is still alive when he says this. He says this old law is going to remain intact, fully functional until every jot. And you maybe say, what in the world is that? That's the smallest little Hebrew letter there is. He says the old law is going to stay in place until the every jot, the smallest Hebrew letter, and every tittle, that's the smallest little stroke that they would make when they wrote their Hebrew. The law is going to stay in place until every one of those things is fulfilled. In other words, what he was saying was the old law is not going to pass away until every precise point, until every matter, no matter how small, no matter how big, is completed. Till it's fulfilled, and it was on the cross. Colossians 2:14, blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us, which was contrary to us, and he took it out of the way, nailing it to his cross. Jesus says, I'm the fulfillment to this old law. And I'm going to take that old law and I'm going to nail it to the cross. He did, as we see reported for us after his death in Colossians 2:14. It's no longer in existence. It's no longer in effect. The new law has come and been established. So let me talk for just a minute about being obedient to God's law. Listen to Matthew 5:19. "Whosoever therefore shall break one of these least commandments and shall teach men so, he shall be called the least in the kingdom of heaven. But whosoever shall do and teach them, the same shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven." Let me just tell you, these men that Jesus is talking to, these Pharisees, these scribes, many of them were reckless. Many of them pertaining to God's law not only were reckless, they were inconsistent. They were flippant about God's law. It doesn't matter if I do it. It does matter if I do it. Not only that, they were oftentimes outright disobedient. And they just established their own way to do it. Many of these Jewish leaders were simply hypocritical men who were going around and teaching others to be disobedient to God through their own teachings that they're teaching them. Jesus, he doesn't have a hard time telling them that they've got a problem. I'm going to tell you, going out and being hypocritical and then teaching other people different laws and telling them to follow your laws, it's a pretty sorry approach to have to God's law. But do we find that going on at all today? I find it interesting sometimes when I study with someone and I'll say, but that's interesting because if you flip over here, God's word says, and you tell them and they're like, I don't care what it says. I'll do it my way. You can do it your way, but you're not going to get the results that you're hoping for. I don't like to say that. My desire is for each of us as Christians to simply understand, as Jesus is telling us here, he was the fulfillment of the law. He brought in the new law into effect, and we have to live according to this new law. It seems illogical for me to believe that there's a place called heaven, but not believe that there's a way to live righteously to get to heaven. Does that just seem illogical to believe in heaven but think it's a free-for-all to get there? It just doesn't make sense, right? The coexist bumper stickers on the back of the car with all the different symbols, Islam, Buddha, Christianity, universalism, agnosticism. How do all those go to the same place? It's illogical. And Christ makes it very clear. He is the fulfillment of the law. And he brought this new law into effect. That new law is what allows us to get to heaven. It's interesting that as we look here, Jesus makes it very clear that those who go out and are teaching things that are not in alignment with the scriptures are going to be considered the least in the kingdom. You know, there's too many people in the church today who are not concerned about being right in all points. And they're willing to go out and reject what the Bible teaches to do what they prefer. I could list a whole bunch of examples, but I won't. But let me just give you one or two that you probably see taking place all the time. And you may see this happening, and you don't even realize that what they're doing is not okay. We learn through the Bible, through commands, through examples, through pattern. The list goes on and on. One of the things that congregations are starting to do today, this isn't new. They're trying to implement things that you never saw in a first century congregation. You didn't even really see probably until 20 years ago. But one of the examples I could be would, well, let's talk about taking all the youth out of here right now. And let's take them all downstairs and let's take two or three adults. Let's take them down and have them watch them. What do we call that? Youth worship. Do we do that here? No, we don't do that here. You may wonder, well, what's the big deal with that? For many people, they don't have any reason to believe that's a big deal. Well, it is a problem. One, we're commanded in the scriptures to worship together in the assembly. We don't separate members during the assembly. We all come together. So if I send the youth downstairs with an adult, one, I got to take adults out of the assembly to go down there. That divides the worship. Then I've got the youth down there. I say, well, where's the authorization for the youth to be down there? Because when I read the books of Ephesians and Colossians, Paul writes directly to the youth who are in the assembly. He calls them out by name. Children, obey your parents. He goes on. He's speaking directly to the youth in the assembly. Guess what? The parents were in the assembly. The youth were in the assembly. And you may say, why is that so important? We as parents are taught to instruct our youth through example. So why are they in the assembly? Because we teach through example. We don't separate the congregation at all. All of us worship together. And even though those youth are young and they're not baptized believers, they're learning through our example. They're seeing men lead singing. They're seeing men give the word of God. They're seeing men lead the Lord's Supper. You might say, why is all that important? Because Jesus makes it very clear that we need to be obedient to the law which he came to fulfill. That's why we even have the entire New Testament. And he goes on and he says, those who are teaching things contrary to the scriptures, they're going to be the least in the kingdom of heaven. I find it interesting that in the religious world today, there are many who say, let's not sweat the small stuff. Let's just major on the majors and minor on the minors. That's what I was taught. When I was trying to find the church, I didn't know where to go, so I just went to a place where everybody went. You know what the name of that kind of congregation is, right? I didn't know where to go. I didn't. So we went there for 8 years, even though I'd look at my Bible and say, no, wait a minute, that's not in here. But I remember their pastor would often come up and say, let's just major on the majors and minor on the minors. And I began to read my scriptures, and I thought to myself, I don't find anything in here that is minor. Uzzah. Studied the ark. He touched it. He wasn't supposed to. He was trying to do something right, right? What happened to him? He got killed. Where are the minor things in the Bible? When the Bible says to do something this way and you don't do it that way, there's a consequence for it. There are no majors and minors. Everything in the Bible is a major. And so I find it so interesting that there are those who aren't concerned about, as they call it, the small things. We need to be concerned about sound doctrine. You know, the Bible tells us time and time again to be concerned about sound doctrine. Listen to Jude 1:3. Beloved, when I gave all diligence to write unto you of the common salvation, it was needful for me to write unto you and exhort you that ye should earnestly contend for the faith which was once delivered unto the saints. That's the same faith talked about in Ephesians 2:8 and 9. He's talking about the faith, the system of faith, the law of Christ, the New Testament. You need to contend for that. We see in Titus 1:9, holding fast the faithful word, as he has been taught, that he may be able by sound doctrine both to exhort and to convince the gainsayers. Hold fast. Be faithful, he says in Titus 1:9, to this sound doctrine, so that you can build up, that you can exhort, and so that you can correct those gainsayers or those who are teaching otherwise. I've often told you, you know, when you're studying with somebody, and it took me a while to get out of the habit of that. Don't ever say, I think. Don't ever say, I feel. Feelings can deceive you. You find in the Old Testament people being deceived by feelings, but the Word of God will not. Someone says, for example, I'm saved by faith. You say, you are saved by faith, but not by faith only. James 2:24. Be able to give the verses. Because when somebody can hear you give and cite the actual verse, it's believable. It's funny when I talk to people sometimes, they'll say, well, the Bible teaches. And then they'll tell me something. I'm like, can you tell me where it teaches that? You know, most of the time they can't. As Christians, we need to be able to show them sound doctrine. 2 Corinthians 13:5, examine yourselves whether ye be in the faith. Listen to that again, the faith. There's one faith. There are not a thousand faiths all going to the same place. He says, examine yourselves whether you be in the faith. Prove your own selves. Know ye not your own selves, how that Jesus Christ is in you, except ye be reprobates. I don't think many people today ask themselves literally if they're in the faith. I did, and I try to explain that to people oftentimes. When people, how many of you have ever had someone ask you, how do you know the church you go to is the right church? Anybody ever had somebody ask you that? I have. And normally what I do logically, and if you're here today and you're visiting and you've never done this, I want you to do this. If you don't go to a church that teaches what the Church of Christ teaches, I want you to go in and on a piece of paper list every religious group you can find, every one of them. I don't care what they are. I don't mind naming them. Pentecostal, Baptist, Catholic, you name them all, Lutheran, Methodist, put them all in there. And then I want you to go to each of those groups and study that group and say, do they teach anything at all that's not found in the Bible? Do they command or bind anything that's not found in the Bible? Or do they leave anything out? And if you find anything they teach that's not in alignment with the Scriptures, mark it off the list. That's what I did. I started marking them off the list. My wife and I went there and I'd see them worship and I'd go, yeah, I heard them teach that. That's not right. They're off the list. You know what I got to when I got no more bubbles left on my page? Guess what church I had? The Church of Christ, Romans 16:16. The churches of Christ. Yeah, it's called other things, Church of God. Those names have been taken today by groups who teach things that aren't scriptural. The Church of Christ that we have today is the faith we're talking about here, that Christ came to institute and fulfill the old law to bring this church into existence. And we see very clearly that we are to check ourselves to see if we're in the faith. I wish more people would do this. We need to understand that there are some things when we begin to look at the scribes and the Pharisees that we need to avoid. Listen to Matthew 5:20. He says, for I say unto you that except your righteousness shall exceed the righteousness of the scribes and the Pharisees, ye shall in no case enter into the kingdom of heaven. You know, if we're going to be pleasing to God, we need to exceed the quantity and quality of these people he's talking about, the Pharisees. He says, you've got to exceed that. Let me give you three things that we have to do better in than the Pharisees and the scribes if we want to be righteous. One of the things we first see about these people, we don't just see it here, we see it all throughout the New Testament. These people oftentimes were disobedient. Let me say most times, you go back, you'll find that there were a couple of Jews specifically called out who were living righteous according to God's law prior to Christ dying. They were living according to God's law, and they were doing it correctly. They had faith. They were living by God's law. They were doing everything that they did because of that faith. There wasn't any legalism in there. They were living as God's holy people. We see that they disobeyed. Listen to Hebrews 5:8-9. Though he were a son, yet learned he obedience by the things which he suffered. Talking about Jesus, our Lord and Savior. And being made perfect, he became the author of eternal salvation unto all them that obey him. That verse ought to scare anybody who's living not in alignment with the Scriptures. I don't say that because I like to say things that sound horrible and offend people. I say it because that's what the Bible teaches. He is the author of salvation to all them that obey him. And you may say, well, how do I know if I'm obeying him? Again, I tell you, open up your Bible, and if this isn't written down on your notes, add it, John 12:48. You're going to be judged according to his word. So why does it say here that he is the author of eternal salvation unto all them that obey him? It's all those that live according to his word that he's going to judge you by, which is why he would say in Luke 6:46, why call ye me Lord, Lord, and do not the things that I say? And people say, you're all about doing, doing, doing. I'm all about that because that's what the Bible says we're to do. And yet I also understand that Jesus said that his yoke wasn't burdensome. It wasn't to be grievous. We're not told to not do things and to do things just to be... Christianity is not to take the fun out of life. We're told not to do things and to do things so that we can be righteous in God's sight. And when we live according to His law, I guarantee you, a whole bunch of that stuff that causes problems in our life, it's removed. So why am I supposed to continue to be obedient? Let me explain to you that partial obedience is no obedience at all. People who say, well, I may not do everything I'm supposed to, but I think God's pleased with me. Is God pleased with you if you only take the Lord's Supper one week out of the month? That's partially obedient. Is He pleased with you if you love certain people but don't love other people? That's partial obedience. He's not pleased by that. You name me anything that God tells us to do and admit that you only do it halfway, and then ask yourself if you think God's pleased with you. He wasn't with the Jews. Partial obedience is no obedience at all. We don't choose what we're gonna do and not gonna do. That's what the Pharisees were doing. Secondly, we saw that they went out and they taught other people to transgress the law. Listen to 2 Peter 2:1. But there were false prophets also among the people, even as there shall be false teachers among you, who privily shall bring in damnable heresies, even denying the Lord that bought them, and bring upon themselves swift destruction. You had the Pharisees and the scribes, many of them out teaching things contrary to God's law. We're warned here by Peter that there's going to be those who are going to be false teachers among us. That's teaching anything that's not found in the Scriptures. We have to be very careful. I tell you, every one of you that's here, check every single thing I say. Verify. And if I'm wrong, I'm telling you the Bible is always right. Always. If you find me saying anything that is wrong, don't believe me. Believe the Bible. Verify every single thing I say. Because we are warned by Peter that there are those who are going to come teach these damnable heresies. Here's where James 3:1 comes into play. He says, "My brethren, be not many masters, knowing that we shall receive the greater condemnation." That word masters there, I didn't write it down, but by memory, the Greek word is didaskos. It's teachers. We need to be careful if we are teaching God's Word. We are accountable for what we teach. You know, people don't really ask me, but you know, when I always pray before I come up here. You probably see me. I'm praying before I come up here. I never pray to come up here and give you the best oratory experience you've ever heard. I've never prayed for that. I never pray that I'm going to come up here and give the most flashy, the most exciting, the really draws you in kind of sermon. I don't pray for that. You know what I pray for? I pray that every single thing I tell you will be accurate and that I will not teach you anything that is incorrect in the Scriptures, because I am accountable for that. And not only if I teach incorrectly am I accountable, I lead somebody else astray. You know how scary it is to stand back here and stand and talk to you and hope that I don't say anything that's wrong? Why do you think we study so long during the week? And then you've got people who don't have any problem standing in front of a camera saying you can be saved by faith only. You don't have to do anything. People standing behind the camera and saying, God's not offended when you do this before you're married, or when you choose to marry this type of person that's not authorized in the Scriptures. And they go on and on and on. And I could give you a whole list of those people. It seems to offend people. Quit watching those people. You watch one of those people and you hear them say something that's not true, don't watch them anymore. You're not going to find many on TV that are teaching you the truth. They're like a lot of the Pharisees. Not only were they teaching people to transgress the law, they were hypocrites. Matthew 23:1-3. "Then spake Jesus to the multitude and to His disciples, saying, The scribes and the Pharisees sit in Moses' seat. All therefore whatsoever they bid you observe, that observe and do. But do not ye after their works, for they say, and do not do." I wonder how big the congregation would be if our Lord and Savior was a preacher somewhere today. How big would His congregation be? What do you have, 5 maybe? 6, 7? I can tell you it wouldn't be like these mega churches with 40,000 people in them. Because He told the truth, right? He didn't care. He told them what they needed to hear, not what they wanted to hear. That you don't find that going on in the religious world today. Most people pick a church, like, oh, it looks good. They show up, and then they hear the preacher speak, and they're like, "Man, he said some hard stuff, and he offended me." That's what you need to hear. You also need to hear love, but you can't have love every week. That doesn't solve the problem. These people were hypocrites. They taught people things correctly, and then they went out and they practiced something else. They didn't look like what they were teaching. You remember last week I said, how many of you would be converted to living a vegetarian diet by a guy eating a big old juicy Whopper? He doesn't look like what he's teaching, right? The Pharisees didn't look like what they were teaching. How many Christians today don't look like what they're teaching? We've got to practice what we preach. Listen to what Paul writes. Romans 2:21 through 24. He says, "Thou therefore which teachest another, teachest thou not thyself? Thou that preachest a man should not steal, dost thou steal? Thou that sayest a man should not commit adultery, dost thou commit adultery? Thou that abhorrest idols, dost thou commit sacrilege? Thou that makest thy boast of the law, through breaking the law dishonorest thou God? For the name of God is blasphemed among the Gentiles through you, as it is written." Not enough to call ourselves Christians. We need to be walking the walk. You've heard it, right? If it looks like a duck and quacks like a duck, it's probably a duck. If he walks like a Christian, lives like a Christian, acts like a Christian, he's probably a Christian. It's important that we understand the old law. Christ made it very clearly. He was the aim of the law. He was the goal of the law. He brought the new law into effect by being the fulfillment of the old law. The old law, very simply, was pointing, saying, there's a Messiah coming. There's a Messiah coming. There's a Messiah coming. And when he comes, the old law says, not only is he going to come, he's going to establish this new kingdom. And Jesus says, guess what? I am him. I'm the one that fulfilled the old law. The new law is coming into effect, and there's going to be this new kingdom. Not only is it important that you understand the Old Testament and that you understand the New Testament, it is important that for all of us who are here today that we understand what it takes for somebody to be added to this church, to live according to this new law. And I'm going to spend a couple minutes and do that, and then we'll stop. As you look throughout the New Testament, you find nonstop, starting in Acts chapter 2, conversion accounts. You read through the book of Acts, I struggle with the fact that so many people can't understand how to become a Christian. But I understand it, because I remember when I wanted to become a Christian and I went and I asked somebody, how do I become a Christian? The response I got was this. He said, you just need to pray. Say this prayer. And I said, I don't know what to pray. He said, just follow after me. Repeat what I say. That's all you need to do. And he said, then maybe in about a month or so, we'll get you baptized. And the problem was, I didn't ask this question. My question shouldn't have been, my question should have been, what does the Bible teach for me to become a Christian? That's what I should have said. And then his response should have been what I'm going to give you now. The Bible teaches very clearly that nobody becomes a Christian apart from the Word of God. Romans 10:17. So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. You don't become a Christian unless you understand the Word of God. But when you understand the Word of God and you believe that Jesus Christ was the Messiah, which he talked about, he said, I am the fulfillment of that Old Testament. When you believe that, you're going to have faith. Hebrews 11:6. But without faith, it's impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is God in the flesh, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Hebrews 11:6. You have to have faith from the Word of God that Jesus Christ was the Son of God here in the flesh. He was the fulfillment of the old law who brought the new law into effect. And when you understand that and you believe that, you know he's the only one who can solve that sin problem you have, and he did it by shedding his blood. And when you understand that you have fallen short of God's standard at any point, Romans 3:23, and that there's a consequence for your sin, Romans 6:23, you'll repent of your sin. Luke 13:3. Jesus said, nay, except you repent, ye shall all likewise perish. He made it very clearly. Yeah, you need to hear the Word of God. And from the hearing of the Word of God, you will get this faith, this understanding. When you have that, you'll repent of your sins, but you'll also confess me with your mouth and through your actions. Romans 10, 9 and 10, and Matthew 10:32 and 33. He says, if you're not going to confess me before men, I'm not going to confess you before my Father, which is in heaven. So it's not enough. It's not enough to finally just hear the Word of God. It's not enough to just believe the Word of God. It's not enough to just repent of my sins. It's not enough to just confess the name of Christ. I also have to be baptized by immersion for the remission of sins. Acts 2:38. Peter preached to the Jews, and they said, men and brethren, what shall we do? And he said, repent and be baptized. And then Jesus in Mark 16:16 said, he that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. Notice very carefully, because people today say you just believe. He that believeth and is baptized. That word and is a coordinate conjunction. It gives equal weight to both things. He that believes and is baptized shall be saved. But he that believeth not, the Greek word is disobeys, but he that disobeys shall be damned. You can't make it any clearer than our Lord and Savior when he said, you need to be baptized. You need to believe and you need to be baptized. Why? Because that's how you get into Christ. Galatians 3, 26 and 27. That's how you put him on, Galatians 3, 26 and 27. And people say, you show me one time where the Bible says I'm saved by baptism. 1 Peter 3, 18 through 21. Go read it. But I'm going to tell you what. It's not enough to just hear the word. It's not enough to believe it. It's not enough to repent. It's not enough to confess the name of Christ. It's not just enough to be baptized. Because guess what? Once you're added to the church, and guess what? The Lord adds you to the church, Acts 2, 47. When the Lord adds you to the church, you then have to live faithfully. 2 Timothy 4, 7, 8. What's the point of becoming a Christian, being a Christian for 2 days, and then going out and doing whatever I want, living the most horrible lifestyle I can think of, sinning against God and His Word, and then thinking for any second at all that God's pleased with me, and if I were to die, that I would go to heaven? The Bible doesn't teach that anywhere. And Paul talks about how he's striving so hard, 2 Timothy 4, 7 through 8, for this crown of righteousness. We live according to the Word of God, but guess what I'm going to tell you? We as Christians, we oftentimes fall short of God's standard, don't we? Let's admit it. We do. But God has given Christians a way to deal with that on an ongoing basis so that you can be cleansed of that and still be righteous in His sight. 1 John 1, 7 through 9. If you sin, turn from that sin, repent of it, turn back to following after God and doing right, and I guarantee you the Bible teaches His blood covers that. That's the fail-safe we have as Christians, right? When we honestly and diligently want to live according to God's Word, we understand when we sin, we can correct that situation and be faithful in His sight. If you're here today, I want you to ask yourself very carefully, did you become a Christian the way I just told you? I gave you a verse for every single thing I said, because that's what you find in the conversion accounts. Every conversion account culminated with the act of baptism. Every one. Because you have to be buried with Christ, Romans 6, 3 and 4, so you can be created as this new creation, this new creature. Ask yourself right now, did you become a Christian like that? If you didn't, you might want to ask whoever it is that taught you how to be saved why they taught you what they taught you. If you're here today and you're not a Christian, you want to be added to the church, you want to be baptized, we can do that. If you're here today and you're a Christian and you say, I'm struggling. I am. I'm struggling in this area. If you just want prayers from the congregation, we'd love to do that. You can come forward as we stand and sing a song of invitation.